Welcome to today's class. Today we are going to see these four different distance measures. The first is the cosine distance. Second is the Bhattacharya distance, then Hausdorff distance and eddy distance. We'll see that again this cosine distance and Bhattacharya distance, they will be used for comparing the histograms. But the later two distance measures are a bit different from the one that we have discussed till now. The Hausdorff distance, we'll see that it will be used to compare two geometric shapes. And eddy distance, we'll see that it will be used to compare two words or strings. Right? So in that sense, these later two are different compared to the first two. So now let us try to understand cosine distance with the help of this example. So suppose if you consider these examples, these two examples, if you see these images, they look very identical, right? If you compare them, what is the difference that we see in these two images? Only the difference is in scale, right? Here you see the on the left side, the image is a little bigger. On the right side, the image is a little smaller, right? So if you see the dimension, it is 200 cross 200 and this one is 50 cross 50. So in terms of size, they are different, but in terms of their appearance, they are identical, we can say. So let's say we try to compare these two images with the help of the techniques that we know for comparing the histograms. So let us first see what are the histograms that we are going to get from these images. So from image, and let us assume that the different gray levels that are used to form this image, let's say they are total 8. Okay, they are total 8 different gray levels. So if there are total 8 different gray levels, then we can say that in the histogram we are going to have 8 bins. Okay, so if you just construct the histogram for, let's say, the for image 2, there are 8 different gray scales. So let us say that the number of pixels which are having the first gray scale, they are A. The number of pixels which are having the second grayscale, they are B, and next is C, D, and so on. So that means 8 different grayscales that you have, they have respectively A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and H number of pixels. Okay, so let's say if you add all these values A plus B plus C plus D till H, what are you going to get? The total number of pixels that you have in image 2. So how many pixels you have in image 2? 2500. 50 cross 50 image, so 2500 pixels. So if you sum all these values, basically you will get the total 2500 pixels. Okay. Similarly, the image 1 is also represented using 8 different gray scales or gray levels. So again, in this histogram also, you have 8 bins. Now here, since this image is 4 times bigger than the image 2, you can assume that if the first image, this smaller image, has A pixels with gray label 1, then the bigger one is going to have 4 times pixels, right? So for first gray level, you are having 4A number of pixels here. For second gray level, you are going to have 4B number of pixels. For third gray level, you are going to have 4C number of pixels, and so on, okay? And if you are getting confused, you can just write down those gray levels here. So this is 1, 2, this is 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 and 8. Let's say these are the 8 different gray levels that we are using to construct these images. So from these histograms, we know now how many number of pixels every image has, and based on that, we have got these histograms. Okay. Now let's say we want to compare these histograms. Right? H1 is the one histogram having 8 values. H2 is another histogram having 8 values, and let's say now we want to compare them with the help of the known distance measures. So for example, if you compare them with the help of Euclidean distance, what do you feel? Will they be similar? Obviously not, because first has the values which are, the number of values that that you have in second histogram H2, they are 4 times lesser than what you have in respective bins in H1, right? So if you compare the distance between H1 and H2 by just using the Euclidean distance, it is obvious to see that you will get a huge value, right? They will not be, the value that you are going to get by computing Euclidean distance between H1 and H2, that is not going to be close to zero. And when you are using Euclidean distance, anything, I mean, if you are saying that two vectors are same or similar, then the distance would be close to zero. Right? If the distance is not close to zero, that means that those vectors are not similar. So in this example, if you use Euclidean distance, obviously the distance is going to be huge. And based on that, we can say that these two vectors are not similar. Similarly, if you, let's say, use the city block distance or the Manhattan distance, which is again a kind of Euclidean distance, it's like a bit simplified version of the Euclidean distance. So here also you will see that if you compare these histograms with the help of Manhattan distance, you will find that they will not match. Okay, but we'll see that if we use the cosine distance for these images, we'll find that they will actually, with the help of this measure, we'll find that we can say that these two images are matching to each other. Okay. So now let us see how do we define the cosine distance, and then we see some of its applications. So to define the cosine distance between the two vectors, we consider the angle subtended between them. Okay. So let us say let us consider this example here. Let's say we want to match two vectors which are represented by x1, y1, and x2, y2, respectively. So think about a case where you are matching these two vectors with the help of Euclidean distance. What you will do? You will consider this point, its coordinate, this point, and its coordinate, and just you will apply the Euclidean distance formula. So what you will get will be this distance, actually. Okay. Now here in cosine distance, we are saying that we are not measuring this distance. We are measuring the distance between these two vectors with the help of this angle that they are making with each other. Okay. So here the distance is going to be computed by using this theta. And we'll see that this in case of cosine distance, if let's say the distance is d theta, then this d theta is nothing but 1 minus cos theta. That means whatever angle they are making here, whatever the angles these two vectors are making with each other, you take the cos theta of that and then subtract to 1, whatever value you are going to get, that will define the cosine distance between these two vectors. Okay. So this was the example where we have matched two-dimensional vectors, x1, y1 and x2, y2. Okay. Earlier, we have considered these coordinates when we are matching, like, for example, in case of Euclidean distance, but now we are saying that they are vector. So when you have, let's say, point x1, y1 here, you can say that this is represented by this vector. Similarly, x2, y2, this is represented by this vector. And whatever angle that you have between them, this theta, if this is known, then with the help of this, we can compute the distance between these two vectors. Okay. So let us first define it for a general case where the vectors are n-dimensional vectors. So let's say the first vector which you are going to match is x and second is y, and x has n different values or different components defined by x1, x2, x3 and xn. Y has n different components. They are defined by y1, y2, y3 and yn. And in the last slide, we have defined that the distance d theta, the cosine distance between the two given vector, is nothing but 1 minus cos theta, right? The angle between those two vectors. So this angle actually can, given the two vectors, the angle can be very easily computed with the help of their dot product. Because we know if we have x and y, two vectors, so dot product of x, y is nothing but mod x, mod y, cos theta. So from here, we can get the cos theta. So to get this cos theta, just take this xy mod x mod y this side, so you will get the cos theta. So that is why that cos theta has been replaced in this formula by x dot y divided by mod x mod y. Okay. So in a generalized way, you can say that cosine distance d theta is equal to 1 minus dot product of the given vectors divided by their product of their modulus. And you know, when the two vectors are given, obviously x, I mean, if you are comparing the distance between x and y, their components will be given. Using the respective component, you can define the dot product and their modulus, and then you can use them in the formula and you can get the distance between them. Okay. So in this case, we'll see that when we are measuring the distance between the two vectors, angle is only important. What length they carry, it is not important. Okay, and that is why we will see that we are able to handle the cases which we saw in the last image. Okay, and you can analyze. You'll find that this distance is a metric distance. Okay, and how will you analyze this? Again, you go back to the properties, those four properties. With respect to those four properties, just you analyze this formula, you'll find that easily you can see that all the four properties will be satisfied for this formula, and we can say that this is a metric distance. Okay. So here in the subsequent slide, we are going to define that this is going to cosine distance is going to be used for comparing the histograms or two distributions. So when we are comparing the histograms, the features that we are going to get, we can safely say that all the values that you are going to get in your histogram, they are going to be all positive. In your histogram, all the components, all the bin values that you are going to get, they will be all positive. So if you are representing those histogram in your coordinate system, all of them will actually lie here because they all have positive values, right? No vector will have any negative value. So when the two vectors that you are going to compare lie in the first coordinate, so what is the maximum angle that they can make between each other? It is maximum 90, right? Because one can be here on this line, in this direction, and another can be in this direction. That is the farthest they can be. And what is the minimum angle that they can make? The minimum is going to be when they are aligning with each other, right? So these are the two possibilities to define the extreme cases. So you'll see that when angle is zero, that means that the two vectors are aligned to each other. In that case, the theta will be zero, cos theta will be one. So the cosine distance, which is one minus cos theta, will be one minus one, that is zero. So in case when the two angles are vectors are aligned, the angle will be zero and their distance will be also zero. Okay. When the angle is 90, that means they are situated in the farthest possible way. In that case, angle will be 90 and cos 90 will be zero. So one minus zero is one. So that in that case, we'll find the highest cosine distance. And you and the other cases are going to lie in between. So you can say that cosine distance is going to lie between zero and one, where zero is going to define the two similar objects or two similar vectors, and one is going to define two dissimilar vectors. Okay. And what are the applications where you can apply cosine distance? So we can say that wherever magnitude is of the vectors that you are comparing is not important, we can apply the cosine distance. So wherever the direction is important, we can just make use of it. Okay. So now let us apply this this formula on this problem here. So in our case, if you just see these two vectors or these two histogram H1 and H2 and try plotting them in the space, what you will find that H1 and H2, they will lie like this. They will make actually angle zero with each other. So when they are making angle zero with each other, you'll see that cos theta will be zero, theta will be zero, so cos theta one. That means the cosine distance between them will be zero, right? Because cosine distance is nothing but one minus cos theta, and cos theta is, since theta is zero, cos theta is one. So one minus one is zero. So cosine distance is zero. So when you find distance between any two vectors zero, what does that say? It says that the two vectors are same. They are similar, right? So if you are using the cosine distance, for this problem, we see that though their histograms are not matching, but still we are able to say that these two objects are, or these two images are similar images, or they are identical images. Okay. There's another example where this is heavily used is in document matching. So let's say you are matching two documents, and when we are matching, you just take the take words and then exactly try to match them, but that's not the purpose here. We want to say whether the two documents are talking about the same thing or not. Okay, so let us say whether they are talking about same thing or not, it is defined based on certain important keywords. Okay, let us say in our case, in this example, let's say whether the two documents are identical or not, they are defined with the help of these words, cat, mouse, dog, rat, okay, appearances of these words. So if we are saying that the two documents are same, in that case, we actually assume that the frequency of each word that you have taken into account to match them, the frequency is same. When the frequency is same, we can say that the words are same. But in the other case where the words are the frequency of those words is not exactly same, but it is in same proportion. So for example, in one case you find that the cat, mouse, dog and rat, they have, let us say, I'm not talking about this example here, but let's say a very simplified example where cat, mouse, dog, rat, they have just 20-20 appearances. But, and there is another example, another document where they have, let's say the double appearances, 40, right? Each word, cat, mouse, dog, and rat, these are appearing 40 times. So now you can say that the frequency is not exactly matching, but the ratio which you find is like, with the help of ratio, what you see in the distribution of the words, you find that there is some similarity between the two documents. In one case, the words are appearing with some frequency. In the same case, in the other case, they are appearing in higher frequency. But if you see the ratio between the words, they are similar. Okay. So for example, in the first case, you have, let's say, A number of cats and B number of dogs. Okay. In the second case, you have four A number of cats and four B number of dogs. Right. So if you see the proportion between these words, you will find that in both the cases it is coming almost same. So in that sense, you can say that the two documents are actually talking about the same thing, or they belong to similar kind of area, or they are discussing similar kind of thing. So in such case where the frequency of word is not exactly same, but the occurrence that you find has some relationship. So in those cases, those words can be actually considered identical, right? For example, though this example is for the documents, but let's say if you go to this previous example here, in this case, we can say that these images are not same, but they are identical, because the frequency of a grayscale here and the frequency of the grayscale that you have here has some relationship, okay? So exactly same thing applies here. When you are saying that two documents are identical, when you are saying two documents are same, this simply means that they have the same frequency with respect to each word that you have considered. But in case of identical, they don't have same frequency, but the ratio is consistent. Okay. So in such cases where if the ratio is consistent, we want to declare that the vectors are same, we can easily apply cosine distance, because in this case we are not worried about how many times a word is appearing, or in other sense we can say that we are not very much interested in the magnitude of the vector, but we are only interested in the direction. Okay? So this document matching is a classic example where this distance measure can be used. Now let us try to analyze this example with the help of the given data here. So this histogram says that the two documents that we are comparing has 14 and 11 cats respectively, 12 and 5 mouse respectively, 7 and 8 dogs, and similarly rats 3 and 7. Okay. Now to plot these histograms, in the space, we need four-dimensional space, but we cannot visualize four-dimensional space. So just to keep this example simple, I'm just plotting the histogram with respect to two words here, cat and mouse. So if you just take the value of cat and the frequency of cat and mouse in these two given documents, you find that in document one, the number of mouse are 12 and the number of cat are 14. Similarly, here in this other document, they are 5 and 11 respectively. So now if you, let's say, try to match these two words, these two points using the different distance measures that we just discussed. So let's say you are using Euclidean distance. So this will tell actually the distance between this point and this point, and which is going to come by computing the Euclidean distance between the given coordinates here. Similarly, if you're computing the Manhattan distance, this is nothing but the difference of the coordinates in this direction plus the difference of coordinates, respective coordinates in this direction, and that is going to give you Manhattan distance. So if you compare and if you compute the cosine distance here, you'll see that the value that you are going to get here for these two documents, this is going to be lesser here as compared to what you are going to get here and here. Okay. Fine. So we are concluding the cosine distance here, and we are moving to a new distance measure. The learning from here, what you can remember is that you are going to use cosine distance to match two vectors where the magnitude is not important, only the direction of the vectors is important. And one of the classic example where this is used is the case where we match two documents. Okay. Now let us discuss about Bhattacharya distance.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, can't we have this angle greater than 90? I mean theta by comparing two vectors.
Yes. Yeah. So actually, I said that this distance measure is used to compare the histograms. So in histogram, the bin values will be always positive values, right?
Okay.
The number of, because in bin, what you are going to keep the number of pixels which are having a particular gray value.
Exactly.
Right? Or in this example where you are matching the documents, you are going to in a bin you are going to keep the value which is telling the frequency of a particular word. So the frequency is also going to be positive.
Yes,
so
sir.
This is only applicable where the values are positive, and in case of histogram you have the case, so you can use it there.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Sir, what doubt, sir?
Yes, please.
So can there be a case where the vectors are same but the pics are different, sir? Orientation is different of the
yes
intensity value, but histogram is same.
Okay, so basically, I mean, so when you're using this distance measure to match the documents, we can't totally rely on this, because if you remember in the previous class also I gave example where with the help of histogram matching we were matching the images, but then there were very two similar images where even the histogram was same. So there we discussed that in this scenario where the images are going to be very similar, maybe histogram matching will not give you the correct result, but at least that can be used to shortlist the candidates which may have the probable match. All right. So okay. If you just talk about the cosine distance, maybe in some cases it fails. I mean, it's not true that in all the cases you will find the right answer using this distance measure. So there might be some cases where it can fail. So in such scenario, if you are using the cosine distance, at least you can actually shortlist some candidates for the probable matching, and then you can use a better distance measure or more sophisticated distance measure to match them. So at the example that you are saying that two images might be same, but they are oriented. There is a rotation. So obviously with these distance measures, we are not going to get the right match, because the histogram is going to be same.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So final answer you will not get in such scenarios. Final answer you will not get from these distance measures. But at least with the help of these distance measures, you can shortlist some candidates.
Okay.
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 Okay. Now let us discuss the Bhattacharya distance. And Bhattacharya distance is also used to compare two histograms. In general, we say that this is actually used to compare two statistical sample or two statistical distribution. And later we will see that our histogram can be also considered a distribution or a probability distribution. So that is why we can use Bhattacharya distance there. Now, when we say a distribution is a probability distribution, by that we basically mean that if you sum all the values that you are getting below that distribution, that will sum to one. Right. That is why. All possible probabilities, if you sum, that should be one. So that is why we are saying that for any distribution to be a probability distribution, the total sum should be one. And in case of histogram, we'll see that if we talk about the normalized histogram, then also there the total values will be equal to 1. So this distance measure, though it is defined for matching the two statistical distributions, but it can be used for matching the images, because in case of images, histograms can be converted to probability distributions. Okay, so to define the Bhattacharya distance, first we will define the Bhattacharya coefficient, and then with the help of the Bhattacharya coefficient, we'll define the Bhattacharya distance. So since we are going to define the distance based on this this coefficient, obviously with the help of coefficient also, the information that you are going to get is going to tell you in some sense whether the two vectors that you are comparing are the two vectors for which you are comparing Bhattacharya coefficient, whether they are close to each other or they are not close to each other, right? So let us first define Bhattacharya coefficient, and then we'll define Bhattacharya distance. Okay. And as I said, for the Bhattacharya distance, since it is based on Bhattacharya coefficient, so Bhattacharya coefficient is also basically going to be used for matching two distributions, two probability distributions. And since you get some sense of similarity between the two distributions by using this coefficient, we'll see that this can be extended to implement Bhattacharya distance. Okay, and Bhattacharya coefficient and Bhattacharya distance both are actually given by Professor Anil Kumar Bhattacharya, and that is this from his surname only this name is derived. And Professor Bhattacharya was a professor in ISI Kolkata, and there was another distance measure that we studied, the Mahalanobis distance. That was also actually given by one professor, P.C. Mahalanobis of ISI Kolkata. And in fact, he was the founding director of ISI Kolkata. So these two distance measures that we have here, Bhattacharya distance and Mahalanobis distance, they are given by two Indians. Okay. Now let us first try to define the Bhattacharya coefficient. To define the Bhattacharya coefficient, let us consider whatever the histograms given to us, they are normalized version. Because as I said in the beginning, this can be only used to match two normalized histograms. So even though the histograms that are given to us are not normalized, by just doing simple operation, we can make them normalized. Okay. So let us consider that here, whatever the histograms that are given to us to match, they are normalized. And let's say they are defined like this here. The first histogram has values x1, x2, x3, xn. And the second histogram has values y1, y2, and yn. So as you see here, you have total n different values. That means the histogram that we are considering here, they have n bins. Similarly, in the other case also, you see n different values. So this also represented in terms of n bins. And it is obvious also, it is the at least the minimum requirement when you are matching the two histograms, they should have at least same number of bins. Okay. Now let us consider from these given vectors x1, x2, xn, y1, y2, yn, two new vectors x and y defined like this here. X is defined here, y is defined here like this. What is what you see in these definitions? Whatever values you had initially here for the original vectors, you have just taken the square root of them. Okay, so if you had x1 here originally, so then in place of considering x1, you are considering root x1, and similarly for the x2, and so on. Okay. Now let us compute the dot product between them. So let us compute the dot product of vector x and vector y that we have defined here. So dot product of x, y is nothing but mod x mod y cos theta. So when you compute the dot product of x and y, it is basically multiplication of the respective values from both the vectors. So you will find that root x1 multiplied by root y1, so you get root x1 y1, x2 multiplied by root x2 multiplied by root y2, so you get root x2, root y2, and so on. And on the other side, you have mod x, which is the modulus of this vector. So modulus means you take the square of all these values and then sum them and then take the root of that. Okay. So what are the values you have? You have root x1, root x2. So if you take the square, this root will go away. So you will get x1, x2, and xn. So you have to sum them and then you have to take the square root. So then you get mod x here. So the first value that you see here, root x1 plus root x2, sorry, root x1 plus x2 plus x3, so on till xn. This is the modulus of first vector. And similarly, you get the modulus of second vector, and then you get cos theta here, which is directly coming from the definition. So with the help of this, you can compute actually the cos theta. All these steps I've just copied here. All these steps are from the previous slide. So if you analyze this expression, you know that we considered that these histograms are normalized. So when you say that these histograms are normalized, what is the meaning of that? If you sum all the bins, the values of all the bins, you will get one. So first bin in the histogram, first histogram had value x1, second bin had value x2, and so on. So if you sum all these values, you will get one total. Similarly, if you sum all the bin values of second histogram, again, you are going to get one. Okay. So in place of these expressions here, you can just simply replace them by one. So you will get a simplified expression here like this, where this cos theta is nothing but equal to these values, right? So these values directly you are copying here. And if you just write them in terms of summation, so you can say that cos theta is nothing but equal to I equal to 1 to n sigma root xi yi. Okay. Now this value that you get here, this value, it is called the Bhattacharya coefficient. And let us say that is denoted as bxy here. Okay. Now once we get this coefficient, with the help of this, we'll see we can define two different distance measures. One is called the Hellinger distance, and another is the Bhattacharya distance that we already, talked about. So in Hellinger distance, we see the definition says it is equal to 1 minus bxy. Now, if you see what is bxy from the previous slide, you can see that bxy is nothing but actually cos theta. Bxy is telling you the cos theta. Okay. So in some sense, you can say that this distance is nothing but cosine distance, because in that distance measure also, the distance was equal to 1 minus cos theta. And here, bxy is nothing but cos theta. Right. So what is the difference between that difference measure, distance measure, and this one? In that case, this cos theta was coming from directly from the vectors. Right. But in this case, that cos theta is coming from these, the vectors that you have taken, the vector that you have obtained by considering the square root of respective values. And the second thing we are considering here, the normalized histograms or the normalized vector that that we are matching. Right. So here the vector x1, x2, x3 that we are matching with y1, y2, y3, these two vectors are normalized. Okay. So that is the only difference. Otherwise, if you match this, if you are talking about cosine distance for these kind of normalized vectors, then Hellinger distance and cosine distance is going to be same. Okay. Now, and Hellinger distance is actually a metric distance. If you just again apply those four properties, you will find that easily you can see that this distance measure is a metric distance measure. Okay. Now let us define the Bhattacharya distance. This is defined as given in this equation. So here, if dB is the Bhattacharya distance, and then this is equal to minus log bxy. So whatever coefficient you have got, you are taking the log of that, and then you are taking the negative of that. That defines the Bhattacharya distance. And we'll see that we're going to analyze this. Bhattacharya distance will not be a metric distance. Okay. Now let's try to just first understand here. Suppose you are talking about log function, because you are taking the log of bxy. So let us see how do you plot a log. So if you're let's say this is x direction and this is y direction, or let's say this is a log x direction. So when you plot log x, it comes something like this, right? At 1, the value will be 0. And when you move towards 0, you will go to minus infinity. And when you go towards x, infinity, you will, this side also will go to infinity. Okay. Now here, if you see bxy, that bxy, the value of bxy, as we said that bxy is nothing but theta, cos theta. And in the previous discussion, previous distance measure, we have defined that cos theta is going to range between 0 and angle is going to range between 0 and 90. So the cos theta is going to range between 0 and 1. And bxy is nothing but cos theta. So this bxy is also going to range between 0 and 1. So if bxy is going to range between 0 and 1, that means we are talking about all values which are, you can say, here, right? In this in this range from 0, 0 to this point. Okay. So now if your values are between 0 and 1, and if you take the log of it, you know that it will get negative. Because any value which is less than 1, if you take the log of it, you are going to get negative value, right? As you see here. So to make that negative positive, we are using 1 here. Sorry, minus here. So that you get a negative value, and when you multiply that with minus, it becomes positive, right? So that is why we are using minus sign here in front of log bx, so that whatever you get from here, which is negative, can be made positive with the help of this sign. Okay. So if you just plot, if you plot log bx, you will get a similar curve like this here, what you are getting here. This is the curve of, you can say, this is ln bxy. But if you want the negative of it, so whatever values you are getting, you have to just negate it. So in that case, you'll find that your curve will be something like this. Right? For, you're going to get the mirror image of what you have in the previous in this case. So here, if you see, the distances are going to be, when your bx is going to lie between 0 and 1, here your distances are going to lie between 0 and infinity. Right? Because between 0 and 1, minus log bx has value between 0 and infinity. Like, now you see, when you are going to get 0 value, you are going to get 0 value that, as I said, that this is log x, or in other sense, you can say that this is log bx. And let us write ln, natural logarithm. So this is ln, and you are writing ln b, negative of it, and that is nothing but distance, right? So this axis is going to tell you the distance here, and this axis is going to tell you the input bxy. So when you are entering bxy between 0 and 1, your distance is going to be between 0 and infinity. When it is going to have 0 value, when your bxy is going to have 1. When it is going to have infinity value, when your bxy is 0. And when you are going to have bxy as 0, when the two vectors have angle close to 0. Okay. I'll just again repeating it. I mean, if you're confused. So on the y-axis, we have the distance, which is defined using minus of ln b. And on the x-axis, you have the input bxy. So when bxy is going to lie between 0 and 1, your distance is going to lie between 0 and infinity. Now, when you have distance value 0, that means when you have the value in this direction 0, when your bxy is 1, right? And bxy is 1 is the case when the two vectors are aligned with each other and they have theta 0. Okay. In the other case, when you are going to have distance value infinity, when your two vectors that you are matching, they are making angle close to 90 degree. In that case, your bxy will be 0. And if you take the minus log of that, you'll get positive infinity. Right? So these are the two cases. Now, if you analyze the distances that you are going to have here, let me just draw that plot again here. When you are close to, I mean, if you see that curve here, the curve group goes like this. Like this. So if you consider a movement in your this direction by, let's say, some t1 here, and actually exactly, let's say, the same t1 movement in the same axis, but at some place, some other place, you will find that the value of distance that you get for this t1, it will not be same as what you are going to get for this t1, right? Because on the y-axis, as you move close to 0, as your bxy tends close to 0, your distances become high and high. Okay, so because of that nature, you will find that actually the triangular inequality will not hold here. Other things are okay. Other three properties that we have for making a distance metric, those properties will hold, but only the triangular inequality will not hold. And that is why the Bhattacharya distance will not be a metric distance. Okay.